The International Center of Roerichs presents. A film by Valery Shatin. Ancient capital of Western Flanders, a little Belgian town, Brugge, is a peculiar place. It has as many historical monuments per town's each square meter as no other European capital. Complacent guides will tell you in detail the whole thousand-year-long history of the town, and will shrug their shoulders perplexedly if you ask about the Roerich Pact or about the events that were in the focus of Brugge's life just 70 years ago. The events that, given the different set of circumstances, could have changed the entire history of the 20th century. On September 10, 1934, professor of Paris University, Georges Claver, writes in his letter to artist Nicolas Roerich, "There is something peculiar happening in Brugge. In shops' windows, posters are set out, hordes of people are gathering about, citizens' delegations appeared before the governors to file a petition to the town council. A newspaper expresses with that this movement soon manifests through establishment of a foundation of universal importance." The foundation of universal importance is the Roerich Pact, the international treaty, the first article of which says, "Educational, artistic and scientific institutions shall be considered as neutral and as such respected and protected by belligerents." To preserve cultural relics in time of military activity, to mark the first step towards the universal peace. It was here, in Brugge, in 1931, that this great idea was articulated for the first time. Today, it is important for people to return to this idea. It is necessary. It is necessary to protect culture, to protect cultural sites. To protect, by the way, from people themselves.
У нас, к сожалению, возникают такие явления.
Unfortunately, we face something unbelievable nowadays. And what about the criminality, which overwhelmed the whole country? Look what happens to children. A great number of homeless children, and we all pass by with indifference. Something inside us has already broken. And this is what should be repaired, first of all.
Мы устали от разрушений взаимного непонимания.
We are tired of destruction and mutual misunderstanding. Only culture, only entire super concept of beauty and knowledge may return to us the language common to all mankind.
Мир через культуру.
Peace through culture. It was Russian artist and scholar Nicholas Roerich who was the first to note that the destruction of culture bears mortal threat to the existence of our civilization. It was he who, in the beginning of the previous century, put forward the idea to sign a national pact with an aim to preserve at least the greatest cultural masterpieces in the ravages of war. Since then, mankind has lived through two global war catastrophes. But are the ideas of Nicholas Roerich really out of date now? Grave and quasi-insurmountable hardships burden mankind. Many quasi-irresolvable problems prostrate life and divide peoples, states, families. Even the greatest colossi of civilization are shaken. Truly, the man and mankind are destroyed by ignorance and are restored by hope. The great consolidators of the human race remain culture and beauty. To know is a sweet word, to remember is a dire word. To know and to remember and to know, that means to believe. But who was Nicholas Roerich? What special knowledge and talents gave him the high right to reason about the ways of the development of humanity? Let us open the encyclopedic dictionary. Roerich Nicholas Konstantinovich, a Russian painter and theater designer, archaeologist, writer, member of the world of art, initiator of movement for protection of monuments of national culture. Since 1920s has lived in India. All this is simple truth, but only not entire truth. Roerich is a painter? Yes. But there is no mention that in his pictures the artist embodied the ideas of new evolutionary philosophical doctrine, living ethics. Nicholas Roerich is an archaeologist, no doubt, but the dictionary doesn't even mention that together with his wife and son, he accomplished the largest scientific expedition of the 20th century and performed a comprehensive study of history and culture of Central Asia. The travel resulted not only in the richest scientific collections and lists in Roerich's travel journal, but also in the first books of living ethics. Roerich is a theater designer. It is true, but he was not just a decorator. He was the advisor and co-author of Diaghilev and Stravinsky. Roerich is a writer. Apparently, but the dictionary holds back that libraries shelved 30 volumes of his works. Travel notes and journalistic contributions, verses, essays. In India he was called Mahatma, the teacher. In literal translation, the great soul. The list of his titles in the scientific world on both sides of the Atlantic would stretch beyond the whole page. Here are some of them. Member of the Russian Academy of Art, the French Ethnographic Society, President of American League of Culture and Center of Art and Culture in India, Roerich had lived in India since 1920s, but his heart and soul were always only with Russia. The Roerichs did not separate from Russia all their lives. They pursued themselves as Russians. Why Russia needs the Roerichs? Because they are an integral part of our culture. They, of course, attached their souls to India, that's true. But they were deeply Russian people, devoutly Russian people. First of all, Nicholas Roerich was worried about the state of Russian architectural relics, but he saw his main aim to protect culture in historical, global scale. It is not by chance that not only hundreds of artistic and cultural societies in many countries are named after Roerich, but the International Pact on Protection of Cultural Monuments as well. I set out to take the road. All that was mine, I left behind. You will take it, my friends. The first international conference in support of the Roerich Pact was opened in Brugge on September 13, 1931. The artist sends the conference the gift of almost two dozens of his canvases and his warm greeting. He says, "It is not accidentally that the conference is held in Brugge. The very essence of your town is praying for culture." Here, in this hotel in St. Jacob Street, the town authorities accommodated representatives of governments from more than 20 states and delegates of numerous scientific and cultural societies, altogether more than 100 people. In the same way as the modern tourists, they looked with curiosity and respect at Brugge walls, covered with hoary antiquity. In the same carriages, harnessed by Punch Flemish horses, they listened with interest to the guide carter, who slowly drove the guests to the town's central square, Burgplatz. Famous are the bells of Brugge, writes Roerich in his greeting to delegates. Let these bells be the bells of victory of the Banner of Peace Conference. Under the tolling of these bells, the delegates gathered in the town hall, the most ancient in Flanders. Here, the vast hall of the first floor houses the exhibition of photographs of greatest masterpieces and Nicholas Roerich's pictures. On the second floor, under the 14th century vaults, in a luxurious Gothic hall, decorated by finest carving and marvelous wall paintings, the participants of the conference approved the articles of the Roerich Pact, paving the way to protection of culture. We will hear about International Day of Culture, when all schools at one time will devote a day to perception of national and world cultural treasures. We will discuss what particular cultural monuments and collections of cultural values will be under protection of the Banner of Peace. The whole range of issues on beauty and knowledge will be addressed. This was the first international conference of such level for the whole thousand-year-long history of Brugge. It resulted in establishment of the International Foundation and Committee of the Roerich Pact. It is symbolic that the union for support of the pact was quartered in a house situated on the square, named after another artist, the great Flemish painter Van Eyck. In Brugge, the monument to Van Eyck and that very house were preserved. However, no one remembers today the events that in the beginning of the 30s made this little Belgian town famous all over the world. Only in the town's archive department we managed to find a man who knows about the Russian artist Nicholas Roerich and the conference related to his name. Not many people nowadays remember the ideas of Nicholas Roerich. But indeed, he was the first to say that during the war we should not speak only about food or other things, but also about saving culture. His pact is a comprehensive program of protection of artistic values. So many years have passed. It was forgotten, but look, for example, what Americans have done in Baghdad. Museums are ruined, treasures of art are destroyed. This is indeed the irretrievable loss for culture. We just have to remember about the Roerich Pact to ensure that such things never happen again. In August 1932, Brugge saw the second conference in support of the Roerich Pact. It appealed to all countries to recognize the pact as the official act of international law. This conference first voiced the offer to proclaim such European cities as Rome, Venice, Brugge, the museum cities, inviolable in case of military actions. In Brugge, you will be told a story how, during the World War II, a German commander of a heavy weapon battery refused to fire on the museum town. Any citizen will remember his name, but will shrug his shoulders perplexedly if you ask about Roerich. Nobody knows what has happened with the pictures presented to the town by the artist. They disappeared without a trace in the years of German occupation. All but one. It was found just recently. However, town authorities have nothing to do with it. Nobody knew what has happened to the pictures presented by Nicholas Roerich to the conference in support of the pact and the Bear of Peace. I went to Brugge, questioned many people, and once I was told that some unknown picture had been hanging on the wall in a police station. When it was removed, it turned out that on its back there is a name and an autograph of the artist. I was even permitted to take a photo of them. Look, this is a typical Roerich subject and his signature. I think that the fact that the picture was found only when people remembered the Roerich Pact anew bears a deep meaning.
Зорко мы будем смотреть.
We will be on the alert. We will listen sharply. We will be able and we will wish and will come out only when it's time.
Недавно мы шагнули в третье тысячелетие.
Not long ago, we have entered the third millennium. It's high time to look back to remember what was Russia like on the eve of the 20th century.
Thank you.
Наступление нового года и века праздновали широко.
New year and new century was celebrated in a big way. Indeed, Russia's affairs took a very good shape. The purchasing capacity of the golden ruble is about 8.5 in today's US dollars. At that, export of Russian crude oil is under a ban, while our kerosene is internationally known as the Russian oil. National industry is in full bloom. The main sensation of the 1900 Paris World Exhibition is not in the least the new Speak and Span Tower. The French themselves rank much higher the Water Tower by Russian Vladimir Shukhov. Its benefit is obvious to everybody, while the absolutely useless and ugly, as the French see it, creation of engineer Eiffel should be pulled down. Everything Russian is actually in fashion. In addition, it turned out to be that icon painting and art of building churches is not pathetically primitive. For the first time, the world discovered the whole layer of great art of ancient Russia. And among those who opened it to the delighted audience was Nicholas Roerich. In 1900, he is just 25. The fresh graduate of law school of the St. Petersburg University, he is already a recognized connoisseur of ancient Russian culture. Once an amateur archaeologist, now he teaches in archaeological institute. Roerich is a perfect narrator, and his visual aids are brilliant artistic reconstructions of Russian antiquity. The matter is that apart from the university, Nicholas Roerich has graduated from the full course in Academy of Arts, majoring in painting. Every summer, throughout the whole period of studying, student Roerich spent in Russian remote rural places. The Holy Trinity, St. Sergius and Kiev Lauras, Volga region from Nizhny Novgorod to Astrakhan and further on to the Crimea. Roerich covered this ancient route, the road from Varangians to Greeks, with an easel, and then got down to studying monuments of Novgorod region in Russia. We'll let the heart harbor the thought due to be realized. About the history of Russian culture, beautiful and true, embedded in all people's characters. Painting time-worn walls and lopsided domes, Nicholas Roerich for the first time thought that in the near future these picturesque ruins may turn into a pile of rocks. And this will be not only a material loss. Any ancient monument is the very soul of Russia. And it is a crime for a true Russian heart not to protect it, not to take care of it. Everything is alive, symbolic, even the walls. We have irregular walls here in Pskov temples. They are a bit like wavy. Well, this means like a human body, not austere geometrical lines. That is, there was beauty in everything, something peculiar, living. Look at these ancient churches, at what beautiful sites they are situated. And all this beauty, it also has a wonderful creative energetics, fine energetics that is necessary for personal self-improvement, for spiritual development, for progress in cosmic evolution. Cultural treasures are the nation's stronghold. All construction, all education, all happiness and salvation spring on the basis of cultural values. While studying Pskov antiquity, Roerich could not but visit Vibuti, the motherland of Princess Olga. He saw the ancient Olga's stone and Ilya the Prophet church erected in the 15th century and unceasingly championed for preservation of these relics. This is a historic, legendary place. Not far from here, we have Olga's stone, a huge one. It was blown up. At least the relics of it remained. Sacred processions stopped there. This stone relates to many legends, sagas, stories. A lot has changed for the past 100 years, but the ancient temple is still around, and Holy Olga's Day is triumphantly celebrated there like many years before. And to some extent, it is due to Roerich's efforts. Every nation honors its heroes, its saints, honors its shrines and culture. Today we pray God, we pray Pure Virgin Mary, and we pray our great Saint Princess Olga not to let us forget our ancestors, not to let us forget their feats, for the sake of Russia, for our sake. Roerich probably couldn't have predicted at large everything that happened to us in the 20th century, and at that time he wanted to lay the way to future with wonderful ancient stones. We have stopped in the middle. We are neither in the past nor in the future. We have already ravaged the road and have not yet laid the one ahead. So I suppose that we should more often refer to the classics of this level and to think about the great wisdom to which they appealed. Great motherland, all spiritual treasures of thee, all ineffable beauty of thee, all thy inexhaustible nature in all wide and high shall we protect. Who knows, maybe, if it were not for the Roerichs' efforts and endeavors of other advocates of Russian antiquity, the most ancient Pskov monument, the Cathedral of the Transfiguration of the Savior of the Mirosh Monastery, would not survive into our time. Built even prior to the Mongol-Tatar invasion, it is entered into the protection list of UNESCO, and above all for its magnificent frescoes. It was Roerich who fought for preservation of these paintings and against incompetent restorers. The matter is that a bit more than 100 years ago, here was the so-called first restoration of these frescoes. At that time, they were actually repainted. Here is what I am engaged in now. I am removing the record of this very restoration in 1901. And the entire cultural society, people, artists, art critics, historians, they all very well understood that the monument was much harmed after this restoration, because there were frescoes of the 12th century, and then icon painters came and painted them anew. That's the monument became dated not the 12th century, but the year 1901. So this probably was the main reason why Roerich, and not only he, raised the issue of the Mirosh frescoes. It is sad to see the days of long ago passing away. But what is more tragic is to see them disfigured, faked, and perverted. His extended tour throughout Russia inspired the artist's series of paintings. Those paintings, as well as magazine articles, are his contribution to the protection of Russian cultural treasures. This contribution is no less significant than financial aid of Russian renowned businessmen and patrons of the arts, such as Tretyakov, Morozov, Mamontov. Yuri Stepanovich Nechaev-Maltsev is not so widely known. However, his donation towards the Russian cultural heritage was 3.5 million rubles, that is more than $25 million given the present exchange rate. What is he mostly remembered for? Firstly, Nechaev-Maltsev was the major sponsor of the Pushkin Museum of Fine Arts in Moscow. Crystalware Museum in the town of Gusch-Khrustalny also owed its birth to Yuri Nechaev-Maltsev. The matter is that he was the owner of glassworks and invested funds into development of many temples, public libraries, and schools for workers throughout Russia. Nechaev-Maltsev's family estate in Lipetsk region is still preserved. This is the dwelling of the former secretary of the All Russia Society for Protection of Monuments of History and Culture, with Nicholas Roerich as its spearhead. The mansion was often visited by prominent artists and writers. Even Shalapin used to sing here. This place is also famous for its rich library and the Kulikov Battle Museum, comprising findings by peasants who had plowed the famous field for centuries. The only copy of the Shukhov Tower from the Paris exhibition of 1900 is represented here. For more than a century, the tower has been withstanding the ravages of time. Most likely, that's why it was a conspicuous success in France. But we don't seem to be keen on either the unique Shukhov's work or the masterpiece of estate architecture once belonging to a man who contributed to Russian culture so greatly. This object is indeed a monument of the federal importance, rather than of the local one. We are looking after the monuments. But our life is too sophisticated, interesting, and comical. I've been visiting this place for 5 years, and every time I meet the same person, a wealthy snob Tolyan, who lives in this lavish house, I would say, occupying several apartments with arched ceiling. And definitely he has no idea that once this house was a manor with its own lifestyle. Родина моя сошла с ума. Fear when the motionless is set in motion, when sown winds become a tempest.
Protest, 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 protest.
20-м столетии мир словно сошел с ума.
The 20th century world seems to go mad, having entered the path of self-destruction. From the aged miraculous stones shall we erect the steps for the days to come, as Nicholas Roerich appealed. His hopes were ruined by the World War I. Bloody chaos of the October Revolution was substituted by something even more devastating. In 1918, the Roerichs found themselves abroad, but not due to their emigration. For a long time, the artist had been looking forward to visiting India. Nicholas Roerich was sure that the cradle of culture and civilization is hidden in the shadow of Himalayas. It was in the heart of Asia where he endeavored to find salvation of the mankind ripped to shreds by wars and revolutions. Many world legends have their roots in the snowy peaks. Thoughts about balmy herbs, marvelous meteoric dust, magnetic currents, and powerful energies to the benefit of the mankind will drive you to the same snow giants. Scandinavia, London, New York were just intermediate stops on the artist's way to his major aim. The Roerichs landed in India on 30th of November 1923. They had to spend a year and a half in thorough preparation for the expedition. Four years later, having covered 15,000 miles and crossed 35 highest mountain passes, the Roerichs accomplished their round journey and returned to Darjeeling. The Roerichs Central Asia expedition is invaluable from the scientific point of view. Priceless ancient artifacts were collected, archaeological reconnaissance was made. But most importantly, the Roerichs brought a new philosophical doctrine of living ethics from the Himalayas. The teaching of living ethics could explain the main reason of unbelievable military and social disasters threatening the civilization. For the first time, it became clear how it could have happened that the most enlightened age in the history of the mankind turned out to be the age of two world wars and global terrorism. According to Roerich, the main reason lies in cultural decline, in deepest cultural crisis the history has ever heard of. It was in the 20th century when for the first time human pride set matter above spirit and put civilization above culture. No civilization, no white collar, golf or telephone are pillars of culture yet. Culture is concentration of the supreme grace, the supreme beauty and the supreme knowledge. When we separate culture from civilization, and it is already separated, it becomes a disaster for both culture and civilization, because these two phenomena are tied with human life by fundamental bonds. The teaching of living ethics explains the mankind's evolution by interaction of cosmic energies. Given a hostile reception at the very beginning, the concept was all at once proved by some conclusions of distinguished scholars. Academician Vernadsky elaborated his concept of noosphere, and Alexander Chizhevsky, expert in solar-terrestrial relationships, found a strong correlation between events in human history and solar cycles. Besides, it appeared that the theory of influence of cosmic radiation on civilization development is miraculously re-echoed in the doctrines of the earliest religions on our planet. Living ethics seems to bridge an unimaginable gulf of times, thus bringing together wisdoms of millenniums. The thought never exists without cosmic fire, but the fire itself transforms into creative thought only due to culture. When it weakens, the beautiful also loses its value. The holy fire transforms into devouring fire, and the mankind starts destroying itself. The great laws of the cosmos are ruthless. They imply either development of culture and mankind, or downfall to the abyss of ignorance and self-destruction. If the task of the Red Cross is to care about the physically injured and the sick, our pact is aimed at guarding values of man's genius, thus keeping spiritual soundness. What is the most important in both cases is preventing a disaster. At the beginning of the last century, while admiring the stained glass windows of Basilica of the Holy Blood, the artist might have compared them with the frescoes of Pskov temples, as the most ancient church in Flanders dates back to the time when the Cathedral of the Transfiguration of the Savior in Pskov was erected. Famous stained glass windows are several centuries younger than Pskov frescoes, but the church houses one of the most venerated relics of Christ. Legend says that in the 12th century the Count of Flanders brought a fragment of fleece with the several drops of crucified Christ's blood from the crusade. The holy relic was embedded in a rock crystal vial adorned with gold and precious stones, and the church was erected over it. The church had undergone a series of innovations and redecorations since that time. But look more closely, almost for 8 centuries, every Friday, the relic has been shown to the public to be bestowed. It was not by accident that consecration of our banner was to take place in the Church of Holy Blood, in the sake of martyr blood spilled for the beautiful truth, where so many supreme symbols meet, the true stronghold emerges. That's what Nicholas Roerich wrote in 1931, when ceremonial consecration of the Banner of Peace, the symbol of the Roerich Pact, took place on a side altar in the upstairs chapel. Delegates to the conference also were blessed with holy blood, and then the Banner of Peace was consecrated with the prayer and touching the ancient relic. What is more ancient and authentic than the Byzantine concept implemented in the icons by Rublev? It was this symbol of ancient Christianity, also consecrated with the name of Saint Sergius, that suggested our symbol to me. 3 amaranth spheres enclosed in a circle on a white background as the symbol of eternity and unity. The sign of triune turned out to be the most ancient symbol of the mankind. Roerich found it literally everywhere, in Europe and Asia, on the rocks in Mongolia, and in tombs of pharaohs in Egypt. The sign is widely used on the images of saints and church fathers, in many Christian temples and cathedrals. But what does this ancient sign mean? In Europe, it stands for 3-finger Orthodox sign of the cross and Trinity. In Asia and Africa, it is a symbol of 3 treasures of the Orient and a symbol of 3 peaks. The philosophical content of the sign also proved to be universal, with the 3 united spheres representing the past, present and future: religion, art and science, truth, beauty and good. To bring perfection to the ancient symbol, Roerich embraced the three dots into one uniting sphere, that means culture. Father is fire, son is fire, spirit is fire, three being equal, three being indivisible. Two conferences in Brugge spurred the process of implementation of the Roerich Pact. But everything was ruined when in 1933 Hitler seized power in Germany. Uniting peace-loving forces around the pact could have made it really possible to confront the adversary. However, Europe missed such an opportunity. As a result, the Roerich Pact movement was relocated in fairly safe America. In spring of 1935, Washington, D.C. housed the 4th International Conference on Protection of Artistic and Scientific Institutions and Historic Monuments. On the 15th of April, at the ceremony held in the White House, the final document was signed by plenipotentiaries of 21 nations of the Americas. In his message, President Roosevelt said, "Given a rigid observation of the pact by peoples of the world, we see the way to large-scale implementation of one of the fundamental principles, that is, saving the modern civilization." Nicholas Roerich heard about the signing of the pact on the radio, undertaking a new expedition to the hinterland of Manchuria, the basis of the statehood, has put its powerful hand to the process, thus opening new ways for all companions of culture. The banner is raised. So be it. Light wins out over darkness. Encouraged by the first success of his endeavors, the artist forwarded a letter to the Soviet government proposing to head the movement for accession to the pact in Europe. The idea aroused interest in the USSR, but the foreign minister had to clarify details on Roerich's political portfolio. Here is the document that put paid to his hopes. Mr. Litvinov reported that, to his knowledge, Roerich turned to be a US citizen with poor reputation and, what is more, a Japanese agent. Given this, I believe that his letter must be left unanswered. This day, a year and a half, the World War II broke out. It was necessary to confront evil, even if all resistance seemed vain. Assuming that the world had gone mad, with apocalypse unavoidable, Nicholas Roerich would fight for the salvation of culture till his dying day. Like motherland, culture must be secured and defended. Nicholas Roerich died in his house at the foot of his beloved Himalayas on the 13th of December 1947, having been refused permission to return to his motherland. But when the time has come, huge scientific and artistic heritage of the whole Roerich family came back. It was a donation to Russia made by his younger son, the artist Svetoslav Roerich, who executed his father's last will. Wherever we were, wherever we traveled, we always thought of and held in our hearts the image of a Russian man. Nicholas Roerich, myself, and our whole family have always believed in the future, great future of the Russian people. Look, while we were talking, everything has changed around. Everything is new. What once threatened us now encourages us. After the World War II, the world recalled the Roerich Pact. 25 years later, this very treaty underlay the final act of the Hague Convention for the Protection of Cultural Property in the event of armed conflict. In 1954, the convention was signed by 39 states, including the Soviet Union. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven, goes the book of Ecclesiastes. A time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to throw stones, and a time to gather stones. After a century full of wars and revolutions, we realize finally the time has come to restore and build up. Moscow is the third Rome, and a fourth one will never emerge. These words are referred to Philotheus, father superior of the Spaso-Yelizarovsky monastery in Pskov, who wrote them 5 centuries ago, when the world didn't have a slightest idea of the great Russia. The utterance is imprinted on the bronze beater that until recently was used as major bell in Spaso-Yelizarovsky female cloister. Small bells like these ones were singing the second part. This chime reminded us that the ancient Russian relic is still alive, that people still remember the testament of the monk Philotheus, who had assumed the mantle of Sergius Radonezhsky, greatest spiritual leader and monastic reformer of medieval Russia. It was Reverend Sergius whom Nicholas Roerich called his guide and advocate. Spaso-Yelizarovskaya desert that burst upon the artist's view looked like that at the beginning of the last century. This is what it has become like by the end of this century. In 1989, the belfry crashed down, the cathedral pillars started rocking because of decayed piles, and eventually the cathedral could have folded up like a book and transformed into rubbish. Estimates stated that it would take almost 10 years and 83 million rubles to restore the cathedral. The federal budget was able to allocate only 6 million. The immediate task of anyone thinking to the benefit of others is to help. Only when we help, we get. The two notions of grace and deed need to be understood objectively. Mother Elizabeth, appointed Mother Superior of Spaso-Yelizarovsky female monastery in the year of 2000, has not heard of this utterance by Nicholas Roerich. She doesn't consider a deed that the cathedral has been restored from ruins within just 4 years due to her labor alone. Faith, hope, and charity, as well as tireless and selfless work, turned out to be more powerful than money. Our fault and our tragedy lie in the fact that a great deal of what was created by our ancestors has been lost and devastated with our own hands. And now, at the moment when the Lord is so graceful to us that we have got a chance to start building up again, to be awake to our faults and mistakes and to try to restore everything once lost and devastated, we can speak of the supreme good. If a barbarian is against our activities, we will tell him in sound mind and memory, we are not breaking down, we are building up. It seems as if the whole family is at home again. Nicholas, his wife Helena, and two their sons, the elder, Yuri, an orientalist of worldwide reputation, and the younger, Svetoslav, a remarkable artist. It was he who donated the huge heritage of the Roerichs to Russia. Here are the premises of the future International Roerich Center, the way Svetoslav Roerich saw them in 1989. Who would have recognized the former masterpiece of estate architecture in a dangerous structure with open fissures and caved plaster? But as the old tag has it, who is wise, let him see. When Svetoslav was choosing the place, and we approached the building, he said, "What clean energetics is here. I'm sure that the heritage I'm to forward to you will multiply this energy. The basis is already there." Peace through culture. This is the fundamental idea of the Roerich Pact that underlies diversified activities of the museum and National Roerich Center. Traveling exhibitions, book and magazine publications, seminars and workshops. These activities are blessed by the banner of peace, the symbol of the Roerich Pact, which becomes so important now, when finally the time has come to gather stones. There are plenty of those intelligent and educated people who comprehend that culture needs to be preserved. They fight for it, acting in the space of culture. These are creative people, and we can name many of them. And they become, together with us, the linchpin in the process of cultural rebirth. Not all of us will live to see the rebirth, unfortunately. But this is not so frightening. We will pass away, but you will stay in your struggle for life and will surmount many encumbrances.